the decipher, sometimes what is your favorite part of the service? When you have the message, you know the message from God, but I have to say, this is probably going to be my favorite part of today's service because of what it actually means. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, it says, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always working in your life, even before you accept Christ into your life. It's what some churches call prevenient grace. But you don't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you until you say yes to Jesus and make Him Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6 says, so you have received the message with joy from the Holy Spirit. You know, this Holy Spirit is constantly working in our lives. And this Holy Spirit is what we're going to be talking about for the next 2 or 3 weeks. We even see the Holy Spirit at Jesus' baptism. Now, Jesus was without sin. But He came to be baptized so He could identify with sinners and sinners could identify with Him. In Matthew chapter 3, in verses 13 through 17, it says, when Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John, but John tried to talk Him out of it. He said, I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you. But why are you coming to me? See, John knew that he was a sinner. John knew that he was in need of Jesus and the Holy Spirit to be free from that sin. And yet Jesus says, we need to do this, John, because we have to carry out that which God requires. And when John understood that this was being done in a matter of obedience, John said, Jesus, I will baptize you. But here's the amazing part. It says, after the baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens opened, and He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and setting on Jesus. And a voice from heaven said, this is my dearly beloved Son, whom I love.
Amen.
We see all three parts of our triune God in this one picture. There is God the Father who is speaking. There is the Holy Spirit who's dwelling in Christ and landing on His shoulder. And then we see God the Son, all together in one. One God, three in person, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So as we go to baptism today, baptism does two things. First of all, it allows us to identify with Jesus Christ. The second thing is, it allows us to have a symbol outwardly of what we believe inwardly. We used the example the other night during Forge, that it's like a wedding ring. Once you get married, the wedding ring is a symbol of your love for your spouse. Baptism is a symbol of your love for Jesus Christ, and you're announcing to the world that you're going to begin to live for Him and make Him not just your Savior, but make Him Lord over your life. So this morning, as I said, I don't normally dress this way, and I usually have shoes and socks on, but we have such a special service, and shoes aren't allowed in pools. So we can call it what we want, but this is our baptismal today. So I'm going to ask DJ Covey to come up, and we're going to baptize him in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And DJ,
the floor's not cold. I already know it's cold.
Well, at least you know it. DJ and I have known each other now for over a year. And about a year ago, at a barbecue, his mom and his stepfather came to me and said, our son wants to give his life over to Christ. And right there in the prayer room, he did that. And it's been so great. We think sometimes that when we come to Jesus, right away, our lives are different. And they are, because the Holy Spirit dwells in us. And sometimes you hear these great stories of a person who goes to the altar and they get up and everything changes all at once. But our experience with Jesus Christ is different. Each one of us, God comes in a unique way. Yes. And like trees, we all grow at different rates. Yes. Sometimes the fastest growing tree is not always the most stable tree, is it?
That's right.
Bamboo grows up to 3 feet a day, but it's easily knocked over if it's not in a group. The great oak grows slowly, but in a strong storm it'll stand. So I rejoice in both. I'm out of words, man. I'm waiting on you. And you all know that's not true, right? I'm not.
Shocking to hear. No, you got the bread and spout.
Okay. And this is a reverent act. I don't want to make light of it. This is a very reverent act. This is a very important ceremony in a Christian's life. It's not that bad.
Oh, that's cold.
I wish I had my camera. It would have been good.
DJ, do you accept Jesus Christ as both your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I do.
All right. Well, let me baptize you in the name of the Lord, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, I baptize you. Symbolism in baptism while we're waiting for Julie Franklin to come up. One of the things is we are partaking, and this is an illustration of Jesus Christ who died on the cross. Jesus died, Jesus rose again. So as Julie comes up here, as we partake in the baptism, she's alive. She confesses Christ. She's alive in her sin. She goes down. She comes up clean. She comes up alive in Christ. Or dead in her sins, alive in Christ. I'll get it.
Oh,
okay. I'm careful because the last time I took a picture, they put a picture of me with a great big tongue out and ears open. You see that on Facebook, you know. This is Julie Franklin. She's been coming here for, what, about 6 months now? And it's been a pleasure to see her as she has grown. Julie, do you accept Christ as both your Lord and Savior? Then I want to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. That wasn't so bad, was it? All right. Well, I think...
We're about to take you off here in a couple minutes, but before we do that, let's just go... I have to do my spiel as... I don't know what you call it because, you know, Tara always comes up here and has a story to tell. And she's a hard act to follow, so I'll just try my best. I think the first thing I do want to do is I want to welcome our new members in the family of God. Can we just give them a round of applause? Yeah. As witnesses to this wonderful act, we, the congregation, are responsible to help them and hold them accountable to their path and their walk, and to the walk of life with Jesus. And I do want to share some scripture. It's actually the very last two verses in the book of Matthew, so if you turn the mark and just go back to the previous page, it's right there. It's from Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. And it says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So we witnessed a wonderful event here today. We have baptized two people into the family of God, but we have more to do. This church started here about almost 2 years ago in Selbyville, and so far, You know, we have grown into like the raddest little church ever. You know, we may not have 1,000 people in here, but you know, if you go to Pastor Rob's office, you know, you might be lucky because, you know, not many people do. But if you ever do, and you look, Pastor Rob has a board in there. And if you look in this, if you look on this like post-it board, there's like, I'm not sure how many little yellow slips there are, but these are confirmations and acceptance of faith. And that alone is the reason why the Odyssey Church started. There could be 20 up there. I don't know how many there are up there exactly. But even if there's just one, it makes the Odyssey Church worth it. Our mission has done what we have reached for, to try to bring as many people, you know, into the loving arms of Jesus Christ. So before we pass the plate, let's go into prayer. Dear God, I thank you for this great day. I thank you for everything you've done in my life, God, and I just thank you for the people we have committed to baptize today, the people we just baptized today, God. I just pray, Lord, that we, as the Odyssey Church and the congregation, will hold them accountable to not stumbling and to keeping true to your word and true to your testaments on the journey of life, God. I just pray, Lord, too, that you be with Pastor Rob as he prepares the message, and just be with him, and that we open up the eyes and the ears and the hearts of the congregation. And I pray this as in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Easy to say, to have somebody just say, I confess Jesus Christ as Lord. And we're going to talk a little bit about that today. The real evidence of whether a church is active or not is what's going on in the church. Jesus said that you'll be known as my disciples by your love. Well, this is a very loving church. We're going to talk about one of the fruits that Jesus says in the Gospel of John that is evidence. And that is if we're making disciples, and we have people that a year and a half ago may not have been involved in a church at all, and now they're teaching and they're leading and they're bringing others to Christ. So I just thank God for what he's doing in our little church. And you're going to have to forgive me a little bit this morning because I have misplaced my glasses again. I had them on when I went in the pool, so who knows where they're at. It's just been one of these days, you know? Yeah, there they are right up there. But again, if you're here and you're new, I would just ask you, just forgive some of the things you see. There's a saying that says, try for five. Come back again and try that again and see how we do things on a regular basis. But this is a great day to be here. As you see, we've already baptized a couple people. We've got more people being baptized tonight. They confess Jesus Christ as Lord, confessed him as their Savior. And this is a symbol of a commitment of how they're going to live from this point forward. So just I thank God for that. But as I already said, this is only possible through the power of the Holy Spirit. And one of the many reasons that it's such a great day to be here today is because we're going to start a small series of messages specifically on the Holy Spirit. As you see on Wednesday night, we're actually spreading that out. This is going to be an 8 or 12 week study on the Holy Spirit. It's called The Forgotten God, The Neglect, Reversing Our Tragic Neglect of the Holy Spirit. A lot of you go to church often and you may hear of this Holy Spirit spoken, but you don't hear about it a whole lot anymore, and there's very few messages that you can find where somebody's speaking specifically about the Holy Spirit. And I want to let you know something. I don't want to ruin the surprise ending, but you don't want to miss any of these messages. But the very last message, 2 weeks from now, you really don't want to miss because it will be a super message. So I'm going to start off this morning. I want to sort of start off by asking a very simple question. And the question I want you to think about this morning is, what is the role of the Holy Spirit in your life? Or maybe a better way to ask this is like this. Is what is the function of the Holy Spirit in my life and in your life? In other words, how does the Holy Spirit inspire our lives? And how do we respond to the inspiration of the Holy Spirit? And in order to help answer this question today, you know, what I did is I started looking at a number of the ways of people in Scripture of how the Holy Spirit affected them and how they responded to the Holy Spirit. Now, we sometimes think about the Holy Spirit as if the Holy Spirit didn't come until the day of Pentecost. Now, we just had a lesson a couple weeks ago on the day of Pentecost. That was, Pentecost is a Greek word that means 50. Jesus had told his disciples after he was resurrected that he would send them a comforter, send them this Holy Spirit. And Jesus stayed among us for about 40 days, stayed among his disciples for about 40 days and told them to go to Jerusalem and wait. And then he ascended back into heaven. And it wasn't until 10 days later that this Holy Spirit came. It's what we call the birthday of the church. Now, when I say church, I mean the big C church. Jesus sent that Holy Spirit, and Peter gets up and preaches a message. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, 3,000 people were added to the church that day. And the scripture says they were added to the church for every day after that. It was just God was working in this powerful way. The Holy Spirit came upon him. And if you're not familiar with that account, it's found in a book of Acts. And that is A-C-T-S, not A-X, because that would be pretty cool, right? The book of Acts. But A-C-T-S, it comes right after the four Gospels, second chapter. And I'm telling you, just take the time to read those two chapters, chapter 1 and chapter 2. But if you're like me, you're going to get wrapped up in that, and you're just going to want to read the whole chapter. There is so much information there. It's so exciting. And we're able to see how this Holy Spirit, this triune God, Father, Son, Jesus Christ, all Holy Spirit, all worked through the apostles and the acts that they did. That's where we get the name from. And it just grabs me. So I read the first chapter, then I got excited about the second chapter, and I just kept on going. But the fact is, we're actually introduced to the Holy Spirit in the very first chapter of our Bibles, back in the Old Testament, Genesis, the very first book, in the very first chapter, in the second verse. God doesn't waste any time telling us about this Holy Spirit. Genesis 1, verse 2 says, the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. There's the Spirit of God in the very beginning. And the other thing that's interesting about the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit is described in a number of different ways in Scripture. We see the Holy Spirit, as we talked about today, as a dove. We see the Holy Spirit as a fire. We see the Holy Spirit as a radiant light upon Moses' face. In fact, it was so radiant that he had to wear a cloth over his face so it didn't blind the people around him. We see the Holy Spirit as a cloud on Mount Sinai. One of my favorite descriptions of the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit is described twice in the Bible as the finger of God. I think that's just a wonderful illustration of what the Holy Spirit truly is. The Holy Spirit comes to us in many different ways. On the day of Pentecost, they said it sounded like the rushing wind. We see the Holy Spirit descending from heaven. We hear about the Holy Spirit being poured out. We see the Holy Spirit coming as people were laid hands on. The Spirit came like tongues of fire. The Spirit is like a golden oil. These are just a few ways that we see how the Holy Spirit is talked about all throughout Scripture. One of the problems that I think I've seen in churches over the years, and I understand it because we're human, is we believe that the Holy Spirit should come on everybody as it came upon us. That we had this experience, and if you didn't have this experience, then you're not really filled with the Holy Spirit. But the fact of the matter is, our relationship with Jesus Christ is tailored to us, just as I have four children, and I love each one of them dearly, but my relationship with each one of them is different. I don't come to each one of them the same way. You know, my oldest daughter, when she was younger, just a threat of a punishment would send her on the right track. As she got older, that didn't work so well. My youngest daughter, when she was 1 year old, it didn't matter what you did to her. She was so stubborn that if she didn't want to do it, there was very few punishments that worked. So I couldn't approach them the same way. Well, Christ came to us all the same way. Not all of us would come to Christ, right? He comes to us uniquely. So our experience with the Holy Spirit is unique as well. And I think sometimes we forget how important the Holy Spirit is in the work of salvation. We talk about accepting Christ into our heart. We pray to our Father. But we seldom think about the work of the Holy Spirit. And I want you to think about it this way. You know, somebody's going to build a great building, a great piece of architecture. The person who owns the building, the person who initiates the project, is always remembered, right? This has nothing to do with politics, but if you go to any of the buildings that Donald Trump has designed, whose name's at the top of it, right? He's remembered. The architect, the person who is putting it all together and actually going to have somebody carry out the work, they're also remembered. But what about the ones who do all the hard work? What about the construction workers? What about the ones that are driving the nails and putting the metal framing up and putting all the hard work in heaven? How often are each one of those remembered? So often in salvation, we think the same way. When we talk about salvation this morning, what we're talking about is when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and we surrender our lives to His will and we make Jesus the Lord over our lives. And then the Scripture tells us the Holy Spirit enters into us to give us this power. Now, what's amazing to me is the amount of power that we have and we don't even know that we have, because the Scriptures tell us, these ancient Scriptures have been saved for thousands of years, throughout the years, it tells us that the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now, how much power does it take to raise somebody from the dead? The same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead dwells within us. But in the work of salvation, we sometimes forget to recognize the Holy Spirit because of His task. We know that God the Father designed the plan of salvation, and we know Jesus Christ carried out the plan on the cross, but we forget sometimes that it's the Holy Spirit that actually does the work behind the scenes. He's the one who's working in your heart. And we pray to God our Father who art in heaven. Scripture says to ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray to Jesus Christ. But how often do we truly pray simply to the Holy Spirit? You know, sometimes I think maybe we think of the Holy Spirit as sort of a description, or maybe we think of the Holy Spirit as a phrase, but I don't think most people, even those of us who do, you know, do this all the time, sometimes we forget that the Holy Spirit is not just a thing, it's not just a phrase, that the Holy Spirit is a person. He's the third person of the triune God. And you can't talk about the Holy Spirit without talking about the Trinity. You have God the Father, you have God the Son, and you have God the Holy Spirit. He is the third part of our triune God. And I don't pretend, and I don't even want to try to let you think that I'm going to be able to fully explain the whole work of the Holy Spirit on this morning. And first of all, I'm not qualified to do that. And the second thing is, I don't believe anybody's qualified to do that. I don't think anybody's fully qualified to explain all the workings of the Holy Spirit. So this morning, I'm going to talk to you about just one simple part about the Holy Spirit, but it is a very important part of this Holy Spirit. I want to talk to you about the Holy Spirit being your life coach. Thinking of the Holy Spirit as a coach. And I want to make it clear that, you know, I'm not an expert on Hebrew. I'm not an expert on Greek. But what I do is I study people and I read articles and I read things from people who are experts in Hebrew and Greek. And I don't just take their word for it. Once I see something, I go back and study the other sources to make sure that this one person is not giving false teachings. I want to make sure that what I'm telling you is truth. So I go through and I read articles from researchers and experts concerning original translations and some of these ancient scriptures and historical records that have been preserved for centuries and centuries and compiled in what we call the Bible. And if you really start studying how all that came about, that in itself should be evidence that our Bible is inspired by God Himself. The Bible itself should be evidence of the living God. But we see in John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus says this, and this time I'm going to be reading it from the New International Version. It says, I will ask the Father, and He will give you another counselor to be with you forever. Now, depending on the translation you have, that verse is going to read in a couple different ways. Some translations, it will say advocate. You know, I'm going to send you another advocate to be with you forever, or counselor or comforter. And the reason is, the word that Jesus uses here is a Greek word that is parakletos. And I'm probably mispronouncing it. It's commonly translated paraclete. And there's there's a couple other verses, or a couple other words in the Bible that have the same root as this word. Parakleto has the same root. Paraklesis has the same root. So our English language, because Greek doesn't always translate perfectly into English, our Greek language, our English translation sometimes translates these words encourage. Sometimes it translates it urge, or to exhort, or to implore, or to counsel, or to console, or maybe even to advocate. So this morning, we're going to look at the Holy Spirit as a coach for our lives. And the reason I want to do this is because think about what a coach does. I mean, if you follow sports or you follow any field that has a coach in it, maybe personal development for a life coach, isn't a coach somebody who encourages you? Mm-hmm. Isn't a coach someone who urges you or exhorts you, or another word for exhort is to advise? Isn't a coach someone who, implore means to appeal, it's somebody who appeals to you, somebody that counsels you, comforts you, consoles you at times? Sometimes doesn't an athlete's coach have to be as advocate to the referee? And if you know, here's the thing about it. If you watch football, you know as the game is going on, as the game's being played, that sometimes the coach, he's off on the sidelines, and he's consoling his players. He's calling out plays. He's telling them what to do. They intercede on the player's behalf. But here's the thing about the coach. The coach can't play the game, can he? He can't get on the field, can he? All he can do is give advice and encourage and urge and console and do all these other things, but he can't do the player's job for him. He can only get them ready to play for the game and let them play the game themselves. It's the players who have to get on the field and do all the hard work. So looking at the Holy Spirit as our coach, it makes the Holy Spirit a very good role model as our life coach. William Barclay writes in his book, New Testament Words, that the function of the Holy Spirit is to fill a man, and by that he means man or woman, fill a man with that spirit of power and courage that would make him able to triumphantly cope with life. How many of us have times coping with life? The Holy Spirit is the one who puts the courage into the faint-hearted. The one who makes the ordinary man or woman cope gallantly with a perilous and dangerous situation. You know, you watch some of these movies on TV, and a young player gets on the field, and they see the big player running after them, and they just crumble down because they're scared. The coach comes along, builds up his confidence, tells him what to do. And the next thing you know, the younger, smaller, is so full of enthusiasm, so well coached that he takes on the bigger power. He's no longer afraid. The Holy Spirit coaches us to do the same thing. He said, you will see power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Now the Greek word there again, and again, I'm not an expert on Greek, but the word is dunamis. And dunamis is where we get the English word dynamite. The Holy Spirit is not passive. The Holy Spirit is not laid back. The Holy Spirit is not asleep. He's like a good coach. The Holy Spirit is full of this explosive power. Power to encourage us. Power to enable us. Power to get us to do the things that we don't even know we can do. The Holy Spirit even helps us get the power that He offers us and wants us to have. Like a good coach, the Holy Spirit is in all aspects of our life once we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Now, I don't know if you were paying attention to the Luke this morning as you were walking in, but if you see on there, there's a group of men that meet on Tuesday mornings for coffee and accountability and prayer and different things. We study Scripture sometimes. Sometimes we just sit there and talk, and it's just a great place to be. So if you want to meet us at 6:30 a.m. at Arby's here in Sullivanville, we would love to have you there. But one of the, we've been meeting for 6 years. They've been meeting a lot longer, but I've been meeting with about 6 years. There's a young man there by the name of Jake Macklin, just a godly man. He was a youth director when I first met him, and Jake is now the pastor of a fairly large church up in Kenton, Kent United Methodist, and he still travels down about once a month to meet with us. And it's a 2-hour ride. So I just respect him highly. He's a great communicator of the Word of God. God's had His hand on his life for a very long time. But one time, and I don't know whether he was testing me or whether he was, I don't know what he was doing, but he said, maybe he was just fishing for answers. He said to me one morning, he said, when I talk, I tell people that the Holy Spirit is everywhere. The Holy Spirit is in you. It is in everyone. And without thinking, You know, I said, you're right. The Holy Spirit is everywhere. It is in everyone. The Holy Spirit is all throughout the Bible. But even as I said it, I knew I was wrong. Even as I said it, there was something inside of me that was telling me that is not an accurate fact. I knew better. So later that afternoon, I called Jake back up and I quoted this young pastor now a couple of the verses from a letter written by a man named the Apostle Paul. It's found in the book of Romans, Romans 8 through 9. And reading from the New Living Translation, it says this: those who still are under control of their sinful nature can never please God. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to Him at all. See, there is only one way you can have and be controlled by the Spirit of God, and that is to have Him living in you. And the only way to have Him living in you is to ask Jesus Christ into your heart and put your faith and trust in Him. That is the only way that you can have this dunamis. This is the only way that you can have this dynamite power that God has promised us. It's the only way to have this Holy Spirit. But here's the thing. The Holy Spirit does recruit us. He does recruit. The Holy Spirit works conviction in the hearts of the unconverted. Those who have never accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And He does so long before they even hear a gospel message. The Holy Spirit is sent to recruit us. Jesus said, even if I stop all my disciples from speaking, even the rocks and stones would call out my name. The Holy Spirit to recruit us so that we can have His power. But in order for us to receive salvation, to receive this forgiveness of sins, the Holy Spirit, and to have His power, we need the Holy Spirit to reveal to us that we need it, that we need salvation. You know, you don't know you're lost until you're lost, right? My oldest daughter is named Chelsea. She went to Fordham University, graduated from Fordham University up in the Bronx in New York. She then moved into New York City, and she'd been up there for several years. She came home for a visit one time, and it became my duty, and I say duty, it was often a wonderful trip, but to take her back home. So I had a little extended cab Dodge pickup at the time. Maybe you all have girls, I don't know, they come home for 3 days, they bring 16 suitcases. I mean, it's 3 days, come on. So we load up the back of the pickup, and Taylor, you know, my third child, my second youngest daughter, she's going to ride with me. And Chelsea's been up here a while, so she knows the roads backwards and forwards, and the trip up is really, really great. And the problem is, when we got to New York City, we rocked off our navigator. So I'm just going to tell you that the ride home, let's just say, didn't go quite as smooth. So I'm coming out of New York. I'm enjoying time with Taylor. She's about 15 at the time. And we're just riding along, and we're talking, and we're having a good time. And there's something inside of me that's telling me, you know, this don't look right. This don't feel right. But this is the way we came. It's got to be right. So I'm just riding along. Everything's looking good until I see a sign that says, welcome to Pennsylvania. Now, if you were headed to Pennsylvania, that'd be a great sign. But I live in Delaware. That was not a good sign. I didn't listen to that voice, but when I saw that sign, I knew I was lost. But I didn't know I was lost until I knew I was lost. You know what I had to do? I had to turn around and go in a different direction to get home.
Yeah, absolutely.
In the Christian world, we'd say we had to repent. Mm-hmm. You know, I had to change my thinking. I had to go in a different direction if I ever wanted to go home. And you know what I believe? I think there's a lot of people who are living life and they're just going along and they're lost and they don't even know they're lost. Amen. But there is a Holy Spirit that is recruiting them. There's a Holy Spirit that's giving them signs. Some of those people may be in this room today. I don't know that. But if that's you, you know, this is not to condemn you, because everything may look all right, but in your heart, you know that there's something wrong. And if you don't pay attention to the signs, and you don't listen to that small, still voice, you're never going to reach your eternal home. So I'm not telling this in any way to condemn you. I'm just saying it as a warning. You need to look at the signs. You need to listen to that small, still voice inside of you. And you need to repent, or you need to turn around. You need to change your way of thinking. And you have to turn to the living God. Because if you don't, you're never going to reach your eternal destination. And if you do this, I promise you, that you will be glad that you did. See, I could have kept driving right through Pennsylvania, and I could have gone through Maryland, and then I could have gone through Virginia, and then I could have gone through North Carolina, and I could have headed all the way to Florida. But if I did that, the direction I was headed in would never, ever take me to my home in Delaware, would it? And for so many people, and I talked to them, in fact, I was talking to one this morning, they know the direction of their life will never take them home. They will never take them to where they want to be, but they just aren't willing to turn around. That's like getting on Route 50 and headed west and telling yourself you're going to Ocean City. You can drive forever, and you ain't never going to get to Ocean City driving west on Route 50. But people do it all the time. You got to look at the signs. You got to listen to your gut and repent. Now, so often, you know, repent is used as such a negative connotation in churches, and it's such a simple word when you look at the root. All it simply means is you change your way of thinking. So you change the way you act. I'm driving, I see a sign that says Pennsylvania. I could have kept going straight and never changed my way of thinking. But in a sense, that's exactly what I did. I repented and drove back to Delaware because that's where I wanted to be. But here's this Holy Spirit. He's recruiting you. He's urging you. He's imploring. He's appealing to you. I mean, the Bible even says, because God loved us first. But we have to respond to his love. We have to respond to his appeal. You know, if you're a great high school football player and you've got colleges coming to you, the college recruiter comes to you and says, I want you to play on my team. You have to respond, don't you? You have the option. You can say yes or no. It's up to you. But you have to say yes if you want to play on the team. And ultimately, that decision comes down to you. Your mom and dad can't make it for you. You can't play on a team just because your dad played on the team. You have to make your mind up to play on the team. You have the choice of saying yes or no. When the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart, you have to respond. By not responding, you're responding. By not responding, you're saying no. Like that college recruiter, if you never gave him an answer, you could never play. Over and over, God writes in his word, repent and believe, repent and believe. And I think in today's world, with all our technology and with all our schooling and with all our education, we think to ourselves, well, that's just too easy. How in the world can it be just so easy to simply repent and believe? It's got to be something. I should have to jump through hoops. I should have to pass a test. I should have to do good works. And God said, none of that's true. I'll take you just like you are. Just repent and believe. And he says that at the moment we confess Jesus Christ with our mouth, at the moment we believe that Jesus Christ died and was raised from the dead, that he substituted his life for our life, he became sin for us, that the good news, that the ancient scriptures, which I believe and many others believe as well, are inspired by God himself. They reveal to us that God does not leave us on our own. None of us could do this on our own. Like a good coach, this Holy Spirit begins to dwell in us, and he begins to help us, and he begins to train us, and he begins to encourage us, and he begins to strengthen us. See, we forget sometimes that it has been God's desire since the very beginning of creation to be among his people. He walked with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. He He comes along and he lives in the tent of the tabernacle in the wilderness. He comes and he dwells in the temple of Solomon. He even came in flesh and blood. Now we think about that and we just take it for granted. God dwelled among us, Emmanuel. But do you know how much he must love us to take off the glory of heaven? To take off his way that where everything and all of creation come under his power? Where he felt no pain and everything glorified him? To put on blood and skin and bones to come here knowing what we would do to him? That's an incredible love that I simply cannot understand, but I know it's true. God has always wanted to dwell among us. He has always wanted this relationship to us. But see, it gets better than that. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is John 10:10. Reading from the New King James Version, it says, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. See, often we think that salvation is simply our get out of hell card, get out of the fire card. It's our fire insurance. We get into heaven. But Jesus says, you know what? I didn't come for just that. Yes, that's great. You're going to be with me all eternity, and that's the goal. But I came so you could live right now, right here, right on this earth, and I want you to live life, and I want you to have it, and I want you to have it more abundantly. Not sometime in the future, but right now, today. The Holy Spirit not only gives us a promise of heaven and the promise of salvation, but the Holy Spirit gives us a promise of a more abundant life, an abundant life that He desires for each one of us. A desire that He wants for us so much that He calls us, He recruits us, and not sometime in the future. Once a sinner confesses Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit gives that person the power to change. The Holy Spirit encourages us, exhorts us, advises us, and sometimes He comforts us, and sometimes He consoles us. I have a very good friend of mine now going through a very difficult time, and I just pray that the Holy Spirit will come down upon her and touch her and give her comfort that the world can't give her, that only Jesus Christ can. I mean, all the time He's coaching us and He's training us and He's transforming us. And the reason He's doing that is so we become more like His Son, Jesus Christ. Anybody know who Tom Landry is besides Bryce? Tom Landry was the former coach of the Dallas Cowboys. He said a coach is somebody who makes players do what they don't want to do to achieve what they want to achieve. That's what a coach does. Let me read that one more time. A coach is someone who makes a player do what they don't want to do to achieve what they want to achieve. I want to achieve about a 30-pound weight loss. So I would ask you guys to ask the Holy Spirit to do what I don't want to do, which is go to that gym and exercise. I've joined it 5 times. I spent a lot of money. And in 6 years, I've been twice. I know what I want to achieve. The Holy Spirit gives us the power to do that. Former general manager for the New York Yankees said, the role of a coach is to get the ability and the capacity to meet. See, some people have a natural ability, but they don't know their entire capacity. The coach is to get their ability and their capacity to meet. The Holy Spirit who dwells within us, once we repent of our sins and put Jesus Christ as Lord over our lives, the Holy Spirit becomes someone who can get our ability and our capacity to meet. And most of us, if I would say all of us even, don't even know how much capacity we have if we would operate in the Spirit instead of our own power. The Holy Spirit becomes someone who can make us do what we don't want to do so that we can have the things that we do want to have. William Barclay was a minister and professor at Divinity. He wrote this, and I alluded to it earlier. The Holy Spirit fills us with the power and the courage to make an ordinary man or woman have a triumphant and gallant and fearless life. Now, that's the kind of life I want to live. I want to have triumph in my life. I want to be an overcomer. I want to be gallant. I want to be fearless. And the Holy Spirit can give me the power to do that. I don't know if any of you remember Zig Ziglar. He was a great Christian businessman. He was a great Christian motivator. He tells this story. And this story is about a rich old Texan man, okay? And he's real rich. And he decides he's going to throw himself this grand old Texas-sized party for his only daughter. Now, he's a rich man. He's a very rich man. He's got tens of thousands of acres of land. He's got oil wells. He's got cattle. He's got everything. And this party is being held at his mansion in the backyard of his estate. And now, because this party is being held for his daughter, he invites all the eligible bachelors, all the young men in the area. He brings them all over, and he wants them to meet his daughter. Now, the party's been going on for a little while. He gathers the ones that he selects that he thinks it's appropriate for his daughter. He gathers them around his pool. Now, when you look in his pool, what you see is a whole bunch of alligators and a whole bunch of poisonous snakes. He lines them all up. He looks up at him. He says, the first one of you who jumps into this pool and you swim to the other side successfully, he goes, I'll give you either $1 million in cash, I'll give you 1,000 acres of land, or I'll give you my daughter's hand in marriage. I mean, no sooner than he spoke those words, this guy is in the pool. He sets an Olympic record. He goes all the way across the pool. He gets out the other side. The Texan comes up to the man and says, brother, man, do you want the $1 million? Boy, he says, no, I don't think I want the $1 million, sir. Well, then, do you want the 1,000 acres? He says, no, I don't think I want the 1,000 acres. He says, well, so that's great. You must want my lovely daughter's hand in marriage. He goes, no, sir. I just want to know who the man was that pushed me in that pool. See, the Holy Spirit is a life coach. He encourages. He urges us, he exhorts us, he advises us, he counsels us, he comforts us, he consoles us. He's our advocate, he's our lawyer, he's our trainer, and sometimes he's the one who just simply pushes us into the pool of life to do what we can't do on our own, and he fills us with his power to give us courage, making us do what we don't want to do so we can have the things that we want to have. He gets our capacity together with our parents. The Holy Spirit coaches us. The Holy Spirit convicts us. The Holy Spirit counsels us. The Holy Spirit consoles us. The Holy Spirit challenges. The problem is we all know that deep down inside of us. And yet we fail to tap into the power because we don't know how to tap into the power. So many times, so many of us, we have this power, but we don't know how to tap into it. See, a coach can give you all the tools that you need, but if you don't know how to use the tools, or you don't know which tools to use, it ain't going to do you any good, is it? You know, I heard another story. This man goes into a hardware store, and he says, listen, I need a new saw for cutting wood. My old saw is just not working anymore. And this salesman, good salesman, he takes off a saw off the top shelf. And he says, man, this is the latest model. This has the latest technology. This saw is guaranteed to cut you 10 cords of wood a day. What a guy thinks, man, that's great. He buys it right on the spot. But the next day, this man comes back into this shop. And I mean, he looks exhausted. He looks horrible. He looks like he's been beat up. He looks awful. He tells the salesman, man, there's something wrong with his saw, he said. I worked as hard as I could. I only managed to cut 5 cords of wood. I used to get 7 cords of wood out of my old saw. The salesman's a little confused. He knows the saw. He sold them before. He goes, listen, man, I got some wood out. Let me give it a try. Let me see what's wrong with it. So he goes back to the wood pile and puts the chainsaw down. He pulls the starter cord. Pulls it one more time, it starts right up. Vroom, vroom, vroom. The customer jumped up and said, what's that sound? See, he didn't know how to use a tool. He didn't know how to start the tool. He's trying to saw it like a saw. He had everything that was available to him. He just didn't know how to use it. And I think that's how many of us are when it comes to this Christian life. We have this Holy Spirit as our coach, but we just simply never tap into its power. We have never used the tools and the training that our coach has given us. And even though we have the right tools, we just don't know how to use them properly.
Amen.
So what do we do? What do we need to do? How do we get these tools so we get the power from the Holy Spirit? I'm going to read from the Gospel of John, chapter 15. I'm only going to read a couple of verses, verses 1 through 8. It says, I am the true vine, and my Father is a gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so it will be even more fruit. You know, sometimes, what's a coach do? Sometimes, doesn't a coach come to you, and he has to take away some of your bad habits that aren't producing any good fruit,
Amen.
So you can replace them with good habits which do produce good fruit?
Amen.
Right? You might have to do away with some things when you abide in Jesus Christ, but here's the thing, your priorities change. A good coach will teach you to change your priorities to get the results that you want. God begins to mold you into His Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus goes on, and Jesus is speaking here. This is Jesus says, that you're already clinging because of the word that I have spoken to you. You remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine, and neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Now, remain, as it's used here in the original Greek, it means to stay closely connected, to settle in for the long term. Jesus, here's the amazing thing. This is spoken to his disciples on the last night of his life. He knows he's going to die on a cross tomorrow. And yet he says, you have to remain in me and I have to remain in you. We have to be together. Don't miss that command to remain in Jesus Christ. He goes on to tell us the reason we're to remain in him is so that he can remain in us. He said, I am the vine, you're the branches. If you remain in me and I remain in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you're like a branch that is thrown away and withered. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, you ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. And I think sometimes we confuse some of these words in here because it says, apart from me, you can do nothing. And I'm thinking to myself, well, I can do a lot of things. I put a pool up yesterday.
That's right.
I didn't do it very well, but I put it up.
That's right.
But is that pool going to last into eternity? Absolutely not. What he's talking about here, you can do nothing of eternal value for the kingdom of God unless Christ is in you and that you're in Christ. Jesus is telling us that this Holy Spirit is going to coach us. It's going to empower us. It's going to give us the strength to bear much fruit, not for our own glory, but God, the Holy Spirit, gives us His power so that we can glorify God. And then He tells us the proof of whether we are a true disciple of Jesus Christ. He said, if you are a disciple of Jesus, then you will bear fruit. And sometimes we need to reflect on our lives to see if our lives are bearing any fruit. And if they're not, then we need to get back to remaining in Jesus so that Jesus can remain in us so that we can bear fruit. We've got to get back to the vine. The Apostle Paul tells us in his letters to the Galatians in chapter 5 the kind of fruit we can expect to receive from the Holy Spirit. He says that the fruit is love. That the interesting thing is the word fruit is singular there. Because if you have love, you will also have joy. You will also have peace. You will also have patience. You will also have kindness. You will also have goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. But then he takes it one more step and said, okay, this is what you're going to receive from the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you what you're going to be able to do if you have all these things. He says, you're going to produce the fruit. Now, what type of fruit are we supposed to produce? We're supposed to produce more Christians. More specifically, we're to produce more disciples. I mean, this is recorded in the life of Jesus. It's been recorded by Matthew in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 18 and 19. Jesus says, I have been given all authority in heaven and earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations. You know, you have a fruit tree in your backyard. It's an apple tree. The fruit it produces is more apples, right? It never produces pears. And likewise, you can have a pear tree in your backyard, and you can wish for apples all day long off that tree, but it's just going to produce the fruit of a pear. The fruit that disciples should be making is more disciples.
Right.
But again, how do we get the power of the Holy Spirit? I'm going to tell you a simple formula that I learned at a men's retreat 1 year. And it simply goes like this. Keep your snout to the spout where Jesus comes out.
Wow.
Keep your snout to the spout where Jesus comes out. Abide in Jesus, and Jesus will abide in you. And He'll give you the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep your snout to the spout where Jesus comes out in prayer and worship. Through prayer, we gain strength. We stay connected to the vine. We stay connected to the Holy Spirit. And through worship, we gain strength and stay connected to the body of Christ. See, Jesus told His disciples, remain in me and I remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. He said, if you cut yourself off from me, you will not be able to bear any fruit. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Keep your snout to the spout where Jesus comes out in the study of God's Word. We study God's Word and we get it so wrong, you know. We study God's Word and we've been taught, we've got to memorize Scripture and we've got to do this. Paul says knowledge will puff you up.
That's right.
Right? We don't study Scripture to know Scripture. We study Scripture to know Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because His Word says, if you know Jesus, you'll know the Father.
To be a child of God.
We study Scripture so that we can know the Son, so that we can know the Father, so that we can have the power of the living Holy Spirit within us.
Amen.
Jesus said, if you remain in me, my words remain in you. Ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. See, the thing is, it's one thing to read about an autobiography, or read an autobiography and know about the author. It's another thing entirely to know the author personally. God wants you to know Him. He wants you to know Him on a personal level and an intimate level. And when you do, He said, I will bring that power upon you. And that power of the Holy Spirit will give you you just ask me what you want and I'll give it. Now, the strange thing is, our wants can't start to change. What I wanted before Christ is not now what I want that I had the Holy Spirit dwelling in me. Before, I wanted everything for me. Now, in my kingdom, now I want everything for Christ and His kingdom. And the good part about it is, the more I get of God's kingdom, the more He gives back to me. Keep yourself to the spout where Jesus comes out in Christian action. Christian service. Through Christian service, we bear much fruit. We are the hands and feet of Christ here on earth. And when you think about this, I mean, sometimes we just say those words and we don't think about it. What greater privilege, what greater honor is there than to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world? But the only way we can do that is through the coaching of the Holy Spirit. There is no other way we can do it. When we abide in Him in Christian service, the Holy Spirit empowers us to love and to serve, and it even gives us the power to love and serve those who are hard to love and serve. And as He coaches us to work and grow in Christ-like service, we begin to bear much good fruit. And Jesus reminds us, this fruit that we're producing, this good fruit, is intended to glorify God the Father. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. Keep your snout to the spout where Jesus comes out in Christian fellowship. Book of Ecclesiastes says, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. We are not designed to be a single branch hanging on a tree.
Amen.
We gather strength as we fellowship together. We remain rooted and grounded in God's love as we fellowship together. We grow in Christ as we fellowship together. I am the vine, you are the branches. Now notice this, not branches. The vine is singular. Jesus Christ is singular. The branches is plural because that's us. There are many branches on the vine, and they give strength to one another. And that's why I believe church is so important to the believer. So going all the way back to the beginning, the question I asked this morning was, what's the role of the Holy Spirit? What is the function of the Holy Spirit in my life and in your life? For the day, we're saying the Holy Spirit is our life coach. The Holy Spirit is the one who encourages us. The Holy Spirit is the one who urges us, who exhorts us, who advises us, counsels us, comforts us, consoles us. He is the one who is our advocate, our lawyer, our trainer, and sometimes the one who pushes us into the pool of light to do what we can by getting our ability and our capacity to meet, by filling us with His power and His courage, making us to do what we don't want to do so that we can have all the things we want to have.
Amen.
But here's the thing. It's not just about salvation and having it in the next life. He says, I want you to have an abundant life, and I want you to have that today, right now, here on this earth. So as we close, question I'm asking is, do you really want the Holy Spirit as your coach? Do you really want that? It's so easy to say yes, but do you really mean it when you say it? Do you really desire to live the Christian life? Because if you do, the Holy Spirit can get your ability and your capacity, can get my ability and my capacity to meet. The Holy Spirit can get us to do those things that we don't want to do so that we can achieve all the things that we want to achieve. The Holy Spirit can fill us with power. The Holy Spirit can fill us with courage to make any ordinary man, any ordinary woman have a triumphal and fearless life. But let me tell you something. It all starts with this. I would be remiss if I didn't end like this. It all starts with putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Today, if you'd like to do that, if you want to do that this morning, if you want to listen to that small, still voice, pay attention to those signs in your life, doing the things that Holy Spirit has been recruiting you to do, simply encouraging you to turn around, to repent, to change your way of thinking, to do what your heart is already telling you to do, to have the abundant life on this earth, in this life, in heaven in the next life. If you have any questions on how to do that, if you have any questions on how to live in Jesus and for Jesus to live in you so that you can have this power that we're going to be talking about for the next couple weeks, or if you have any question about today's service, just see me or one of our volunteers after the service. Allow me the privilege to please pray for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this group of people that have come here today. Lord, we thank you for the good fruit that you've been producing here today. We thank you that we have seen fruit produced in DJ and in Julie today as they come to you and as an outward symbol of their love for you have been baptized today, Lord. What a great privilege for me to be part of that, and I thank them and I thank you, Lord, for allowing me to participate. And Father, we just come to you today, Lord. Give us the desire. But then, Lord, sometimes just give us that nudge to push us into the pool of light, to make us do the things that maybe we don't want to do so that we can achieve all that we want to achieve. I ask you in the wonderful name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit and the authority of the Father. Amen.